Waits, Colin Pitts of McMillan, Pass, and Smith Architects, Joe Sessoms, local radio personality and aviation enthusiast. If you haven't met Joe, he's a treat. Chris Pelkey works with Ryder Trucking Company, and Mike Bradley, who's director of operations for Stratus Air, which is a subsidiary of Johnson Development. And myself, a lawyer and a pilot. The first I do, so I can pay for the second. And we're led by our airport director, Terry Connerton, behind me, and he has done an outstanding job, particularly considering he followed in the footsteps of a legend, Darwin Simpson. And more about Terry's accomplishments in a little bit. But the contributions of Darwin Simpson cannot be overstated. He led us through a renaissance of our airport operations. He was paid a grand total of $1 per year. He did that for several years. And due to Darwin's efforts, we have a newly renovated airport building and much needed taxi space. His dedication to us runs parallel with his dedication to our country. He achieved the rank of general in our armed forces. And our landing area is now named Darwin Simpson Field, and rightfully so. All of your advisory committee members share common goals, and that is to provide input in making our airport a model for harmony and achieving, number one, a gateway for city and county economic success. Two, an efficient operation which attracts business and general aviation operators. And three, a safe environment which encourages participation from our citizens. I'd like to share with you some information about airports in South Carolina. Then I want to discuss the highlights of our airport specifically, and then end with a conversation about the city, the county, and respective relationships to the airport. The South Carolina Aeronautics Commission presented an economic impact report in 2018, and it concluded that airports and airport-supported activities in South Carolina were creating an estimated $653 billion in total annual economic impact. Now, admittedly, $4.2 billion of that is from Boeing. And in that study, economic activity surrounding airports was defined as the sum of annual payroll and spending. Employees, jobs, over 122,000. Annual payroll, $4.8 billion. Annual spending, $11.5 billion. And as the report noted, airports are essential to South Carolina's transportation infrastructure and economy. Now to the Spartanburg Downtown Airport. Annually, over 20,000 visitors arrive in Spartanburg via our airport. The airport and airport activities support annual tax revenues estimated at $1.6 million. There are 328 direct or indirect jobs that are related to Spartanburg Airport operations. And the annual payroll for these jobs is $12.5 million. Annual spending attributed to our airport is $29.3 million. I know that's a lot of facts and figures, but what we're doing is trying to understand the overall economic impact that we have locally. Spartanburg Downtown Airport is responsible for $41.8 million total dollars of annual economic activity. Now, this annual economic impact far exceeds our annual financial need for maintenance and improvement. The statistics that I've just shared with you show that the airport is well worth the investment. Terry Connerton, in conjunction with Able City personnel, drove the runway extension project to a successful conclusion. Our runway was extended from 5,200 feet to nearly 6,000. Now, the positive impact of that extension for our business and our aviation community is going to be felt for decades to come. Capacity, low capacity, so it wouldn't do a whole lot of good if you loaded up a plane that could only fly an hour. When you get to that 6,000 foot number, it's a huge number. You can bring in a 727. You can bring in a unique opportunity and as well placed as an alternative to the Greenville-Spartanburg Airport. If you think about Greenville Downtown Airport, if we were to go out there, you'd see a field that is about 5,200 feet, and it is landlocked. I don't know if you remember, they got a Falcon that landed, brakes lost, and it was a terrible tragedy. We don't have that problem. We got almost a 6,000 foot runway, and we've got an overreach and extension. So when I tell you that runway extension has opened the doors to our economic activity, it really has. It means that you can go and recruit businesses that otherwise wouldn't even pay us any attention. And why wouldn't it be a great idea for them to do it? We've got a great tax base, a great school system, we've got a proactive county council, proactive city council, encouraging business environment. Well, it's just all the pieces fit together. The foresight of people like Darwin and the drive of Terry and others have created an airport environment of unlimited potential. We've got a beautiful new play area, for example. It's airplane themed. It's constantly filled with children and their parents. Under his able leadership, Terry has enlisted a new standard in customer service. Our staff is among the friendliest in the Southeast. This is a big deal when you come and land. Number one, you're looking for fuel prices. But number two, you're looking for people to be nice to. And Terry understands that. He gets it. He's a pilot. He's also an instructor. So he's negotiated a deal, for example, on fuel service that saves us money, upgrades current equipment, has better payment terms, and even prevail on that provider to give business development funds. So Terry Conniter has positioned us uniquely in the upstate with innovative sales and marketing techniques. In short, his leadership has taken us to the next level. So where are we headed? New business opportunities. For example, freight and charter, along with favorable fuel pricing. City Council just approved the permission to erect hangars, and we're in the middle of an equal opportunity zone. That means people could get capital gains, and they need some place to offset those capital gains. They can invest in the equal opportunity zone. If that investment holds true for 10 years, if they don't pull it out, they get to take out their investment with no taxable consequence and keep the appreciation. It's a win-win. In fact, the money that Equal Opportunity Zones is attracting far outstrips the viable projects that are available. We at the airport are in the middle of an equal opportunity zone. And Tim Langford of Phoenix Air is getting ready to build a hangar. So there's much acreage on our site contrasted with Greenville. That means hangar space. Hangar space means the opportunity for more businesses which utilize aircraft. More aircraft equate to more fuel sales and business options. Why wouldn't a business locate to our thriving, dynamic, and growing community? But this facility, it benefits the county as a whole. And while our city population is on the rebound, it really pales in comparison to the county growth in population. Yet since 2014, the county has not participated in funding for the downtown airport. Current unemployment in Spartanburg County is at record lows. Tax revenue is up. And part of that revenue comes directly from airport operations, not to mention tax paid on aircraft. So we, the advisory committee, recognize that our role is just that. It's to advise. But our belief is a discussion ought to be had with our county brothers and sisters to address the funding inequities. You think of it, city's the little brother. You're the big brother. But the little brother has been taking care of the whole shooting match since 2014. And we're sensitive to the importance of the utmost discretion in assuring amicable relations between city and county. We think that this is an opportunity to make that happen. And so we seek to encourage a dialogue between the excellent city manager, Chris Story, and our fine county administrator, Cole Alverson, for a mutually beneficial arrangement regarding our airport. This can include not only a share in supporting the operations, but also a share in the revenue. The more the county council helps us to increase that revenue base, the better the county is benefited. And together, Spartanburg Downtown Airport can become a model of cooperation between our city and county government. I'll be happy to answer any questions you have.
Any questions of the committee or the full council?
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir.
I'd regret if I didn't ask Jeremy a question. I do want to share. All this new stuff they added since the last meeting I was here, I don't know how I operate, since they added all this stuff. So I got to get my mic out.
Ooh, it sounds much better, Bob.
Boy, I tell you, y'all spent all kind of money since the last time I was here. Charlie, too. Now, contributed a little bit, I guess, over the years, Charlie, as being in the state legislature and as a member of the Aeronautics Commission. So I understand where you're coming from. It is a great airport. We can tell you real fast that those cities that do not have what we have in various parts of the state, people, when they come in and they don't have a local airport, they're going to look somewhere else. And the caliber we have here in Spartanburg is top notch. Terry's doing a great job, and of course Darwin did a great job. So I appreciate what y'all are doing. As a former member of the advisory board, I understand where you're coming from, and I think we should look at it. The legislation that was passed, I can't give you the exact year, whenever we changed the tax base on airplanes that were hangered in South Carolina compared to somewhere else, has helped immensely in bringing airplanes to Spartanburg area, Spartanburg Airport. You mentioned, how many acres do we have out there, Charlie?
500.
500 acres, right. So we've got a lot of room. Of course, we're down to one runway. And I would think it would stay to one runway. I don't think you're interested in
that's correct.
At the back of what we used to have. I would encourage it, yes, that you sit together with Chris and Cole and anybody on this council that wants to participate. I think it's something that we need to look at, something we need to be involved in, and need to do everything we can to help it grow more than it is right now. So.
Let me say a couple before you sit down, Charlie. I want to thank you for your service on the Airport Advisory Committee.
I can't remember
a chairman coming and asking us to get involved. I don't remember. So
you're the first.
And I agree
with Bob.
When I think about
the downtown airport, it reminds me a little bit of downtown Spartanburg.
Downtown
Spartanburg was somewhat functional 20
years ago. It's something to be proud of now. Our
downtown airport
has always been really
something to be proud of for its age
and
the history behind it. With Lindbergh
and who was some of the other famous pilots that have flown in here. And
I use the airport regularly, for business with Tyndall, but I also know how many companies over the last 27 years that we've recruited here that have flown in here. And if the citizens of Spartanburg had any clue about
who does fly in here, not just it actually puts business here, but comes to look at Spartanburg, they would be shocked. And that airport is
something to be proud of.
It's a showpiece now. And again, when you fly in, it's not just the low fuel, it's the service that you get and the smiling faces and then the people that are around it.
The other users of the airport willing to shake a hand and offer help to the folks flying in here. So it's something to be very proud of. It helps us land companies and keeps us at the forefront of a lot of companies looking at Spartanburg. So, and I go back to what Bob was saying about with the legislature changes of the airport, I guess airplane taxing. Think back just a few years ago, we didn't have
George
Stings Fleet. We
We didn't have Jimmy Gibbs' fleet. We didn't have even the mayor of Spartanburg at that time, Bill Barnett's jet.
Because it just wasn't advantageous to keep your planes in South Carolina, not just Spartanburg, but now you look what we have. And the more big planes and small planes that are out there,
it says something about the quality of flight.
So I support you, and I support the commission. Let's start the dialogue. Let's get to talking. And thank you again for what you do for Spartanburg and Spartanburg County.
Thank you all.
Yes, sir. The next item we have a request to render first reading to an ordinance authorizing the execution and delivery of a special source credit agreement
between Spartanburg County, South Carolina,
and Partons LLC with respect to certain economic development property in the county, whereby such property will receive certain special source credits. So I hear a motion that we render first reading on this ordinance.
So moved. Second.
Motion made and second. All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
We'll recommend that before council at 5:30. The next, we have a request to adopt a resolution authorizing, under certain conditions, the execution and delivery by Spartanburg County, South Carolina, of a fee in lieu tax agreement with Project Stone with respect to an industrial project in the county, whereby the project would be subject to the payment of certain fee in lieu of taxes, and whereby say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Motion carries. Recommend that to full council this evening. The next request is to render first reading to an ordinance authorizing the execution delivery of the fee in lieu tax agreement bound between Spartanburg County, South Carolina, and certain companies identified collectively for the time being as Project Stone with respect to certain economic development property in the county.
Recommend that full council. Next item, we have a request to adopt a resolution
authorizing, under certain conditions, the execution and delivery by Spartanburg County, South Carolina, of a fee in lieu tax and incentive agreement
with Project Victor with respect to an industrial project in the county, whereby the project would be subject to payment of certain fee in lieu of taxes, and whereby Project Victor will be provided certain credits against fee payments and reimbursement of investment in related qualified infrastructure.
Do you hear a motion that we adopt this resolution?
I'm moved. Second.
Motion made and second. All in favor say aye.
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 Motion carries. Pass that on to full council 5:30. Next, we have a request
to adopt a resolution authorizing the execution and delivery by Spartanburg County, South Carolina, of the fee in lieu tax agreement with Project Tennis
with respect to an industrial
project in the county, whereby the project would be subject to payment of certain fee in lieu of taxes. Do you hear a motion to
approve that resolution?
Second.
Agreement bound between Spartanburg County, South Carolina, and Liberty Street Apartments, LLC, with respect to certain economic development property in the county, and whereby such property will receive certain special source credits. You hear a motion to run the first reading of this ordinance?
So moved.
Motion made.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. Recommend that full council 5:30. These projects represent $56 million of investment in the county and 55
new jobs.
Mr. Chair, that concludes our committee meeting.
Thank you, David.
Yes, sir.
The next committee is Personnel and Finance. Bob Walker, Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Today we've got a number of items on the agenda for our committee, and the first one is to receive information and take desired action in reference to a request from the Sheriff's Office to add school resource officers positions requested by various school districts. And Captain Barry and Lieutenant Liso is here today. So, Captain.
Thank you, Council. Good afternoon, Council. First of all, I want to introduce you to our lieutenant over our school resource. He's what we call our power forward. Chris played basketball at Norman, then went on to star and play at the University of South Carolina in basketball. But he's been in the sheriff's office over 22 years. But he's been over our school resource office for many years. He guides, currently we have 44 supervisors, so it's a large organization we have. Real quickly, this past fall, three county school districts applied for funds made available by the State Department of Education. They called the School Safety Program. All told, seven new positions are requested. District 4 requested one, School District 2 requested four, and School District 7 requested one, two. All total, I think it was seven. Was it eight? But I think it's down to seven. I did contact Cole Alderson and Kelly. Kelly Newman helped us tremendously with numbers. The funding is not 100%, but we've negotiated with Cole and Kelly. The schools have accepted to pay the remainder of the total. They have agreed to pick up most of it, all of it actually, and we have identified candidates to take those positions, and all that will be pending on the approval here at County Council. If you have any questions, I'd be happy to ask, or anything about our school resource officer program, Lieutenant Lesso's here as well.
If I got any questions?
Lesso, weren't you also a big time pitcher, come out of Dorman High School?
A little bit.
We both at USC.
As well, so.
All right, so if I understand correctly, then Captain and Lieutenant Cole, this was authorized, the monies was authorized, part of it, but I'd say that they, and the other, the school districts are great pickups, so basically, it's a matter of us, the county hiring these positions and funding.
It was a little bit less than the other two districts, and what they did negotiate, where they would pay the remainder of those.
And Councilman Walker, there'll be a VAR in your packet to be considered as part of the board a little bit later. And that VAR effectively would authorize the addition of these positions, so they could be hired. And that would be contingent upon the school district executing a contract.
That is, that's a special problem. The money of the state and the school district is coming to us.
That's correct.
We're joining in expense against the money that's gonna be coming in, right?
Correct. We'll effectively do the fiduciary, which is a little atypical for how these things work, but that's the way this one was set up. And so we will work with the school districts to do the application and to formally notify the state who these particular deputies and school resource officers will be. And then those funds will flow directly to us and effectively we will build the schools with difference.
Any other questions, comments? Yes, sir.
I have one quick question. I'm known on your committee, but Captain and Lieutenant, how does it work with the traffic control for schools in the morning and, you know, in school? Are those school resource officers doing that traffic control or?
It depends. Depends on whether or not the school principal district utilizes that SRO to do traffic, or they have the option, if they prefer that officer to be in the school around the kids in the morning, they prefer to hire a deputy through secondary employment off duty to come and do traffic.
So those deputies are hired, you know, by the school district to be out directing traffic.
Yes.
They're not pulling people from the force. So.
Yes, yes. Right. Similar to a lot of football games when they hire deputies for that same principle.
And some of the schools in Atlanta, I know for one, they use local municipal police to go out in the morning and the afternoon and direct the traffic. So those are in addition to the school resource officers we have in the schools.
I've noticed.
Yeah, I've had some folks ask me out in the Fair Forest area, especially with Fair Forest Middle School moving over by Oak Brook, because they see all the officers and the question was asked, who's paying for this? So,
let's
find out.
Yes,
speaking of that, good.
All right. Do I have a motion?
Make a motion. We have a motion.
Second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
And I vote aye, and it passes. Thank you, gentlemen. Appreciate it. And is there any reason for these two gentlemen to stick around? Anybody think? Thank you. Appreciate it.
Against him.
All right, next item is receive information to take desired action in reference to a resolution of historic designation for special tax assessment under section 70-169 of the Spartanburg County, South Carolina Code of Ordinances and to approve an extended special assessment period under section 70-171 of the Spartanburg County, South Carolina Code of Ordinances for that certain parcel of improved real property known as Old Star Mill. And who's he? Are you David Craig?
Daniel Craig.
Daniel Craig, I'm sorry. Yes, sir.
Hi, Daniel. And yeah, my name is Daniel Craig, and I'm with the Johnson Smith Everett and Wildman Law Firm here in Spartanburg. And my client, BF Star Mill LLC, has acquired and is developing the Old Star Mill. It's located at 170 R Street here in Spartanburg. My client entered into a development agreement with the City of Spartanburg and has a resolution that was adopted by the City of Spartanburg wherein the Old Star Mill received the historic designation for special tax assessment. Resolution before you today is for county approval of the historic designation and to extend the special assessment period to 10 years under section 70-171 of the county ordinance. Happy answering the question.
All right. Anybody got any questions? And this is a standard program, I think, we've done for a number of these old meals and so forth, so do I have a motion? Got a motion to adopt the resolution, got a second? All those in favor say aye. And I vote aye, and it passes. All right. The next item, Daniel's got it, is receive information, take desired action in reference to a resolution of historical preservation, professional tax assessment under section 70-169, Spartanburg County, South Carolina, Code of Ordinances, and to approve an extended special assessment period under section 70-171 of the Spartanburg County Codes for a certain parcel of real property known as 127 West Main. Daniel?
This is the same as the previous resolution. My client has acquired the property and is developing 127 West Main Street. This property has, there's a development agreement between my client and city, so he's adopted a resolution. And the resolution before you is for county approval of the historic designation and to extend special assessment period for 10 years under section 7171 of the county.
Now, let me make sure before I go any further. The city has already approved what they need to do, right?
That's correct.
Yeah, so we're extending what we're required to do under the county to follow up this. You have any questions? Do I have a motion?
Second.
Motion to second the resolution. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
And I vote aye, and it passes.
Thank you, Daniel.
Appreciate it. And I don't think there's any reason for you to hang around either, you know, so, okay.
Thank you.
Good.
Next item is receive information, take desired action in reference to a classification and comprehensive study. And the presenter for this is Cole Addison, and I don't know if we got anybody from the county here or not.
We do. We have Quinnell Fox, who will be presenting on behalf of Evergreen Consulting.
All right. Yes.
Good afternoon.
Yeah.
Thank you for allowing me to be here. I'm Quinnell Fox with Evergreen Solutions without passing Florida. It's been a great pleasure working with your county, 106 employees, and we had 1,096 of those who participated in the job assessment tool. So that speaks, that's 78%, so that means that they're really interested in the study. I'll talk a little bit about this, you know, as far as the process. We want to understand your compensation philosophy. What is the county going to do? How is it to compensate its employees? And what kind of pay plan would you like to have? We'll look at review of the compensation study, see what results are in place, and we'll also provide you guys with some recommendations. The first thing we did, as I mentioned, is we came out in August and provided your employees with an overview. We wanted them to understand the entire study from the ground up. So we had orientation sessions here and throughout other parts of the county. And first thing we do is we get your employee data, and we want to understand, do we see any issues? Are there compression? Are there other things we want to look at? So we let you know that before we even start the study. And then talk about your compensation philosophy. We'll look at that in just a moment. The focus of this study is we use what's called the job assessment tool, and that's where your employees actually go online and actually tell us what they do to achieve their job. Tell us the essential functions, the competencies they need, education, sorry, I'm not sure if I'm standing in the wrong spot or what, right there, squeal. Experience, certification, education, those kind of things to successfully perform their jobs. We also look internally. This tool helps us determine, are your employees being paid appropriately internally? If they're doing the same type of work, are they being compensated appropriately? Then we go out externally, we look at your competitors. I guess maybe it's my earrings or something, I don't know. Sorry.
We don't hear you.
You know?
Yeah, I hear it right now.
Yeah, I do, yeah. Okay. It's Roger's pacemaker.
Spending money on heartbeats.
Okay. So that this job assessment tool again helps us to look internally for equity. Externally, we're looking at your competitors. What are they paying employees that do the same kind of work that your employees do? And we also, for competitors, we want to ensure that we're looking at similar organizations doing provide same type services and similar size and organization. And we bring those two components together to create what's called a new pay plan. And so we develop those options. And it's, we'll provide you, or we have provided Cole's team with annualized cost. So it helps you determine when we move people to these new pay grades in this new pay plan, what those costs would be to make sure your folks were classified appropriately. What's to come? We're going to finalize the results. There's always final reviews and making sure everything's in place. And then we'll provide draft and final reports. We're also going to provide HR with these tools, these job assessment tools, which help identify all the components of what the employees say, this is part of my job and what it takes to successfully perform it. And your supervisors also had a tool called a management issue tool. That helped us to identify that perhaps they have five folks that are all the same classification, but maybe there's that one person that does additional duty, or maybe they're always selected for doing this additional duty. So perhaps that position should have a different classification. Maybe it should have a different pay grade. So we'll look at that. We're going to provide the HR team with these tools so that they can update the job descriptions. Let's talk a little bit about the compensation philosophy for Spartanburg County. First thing you want to think about is, what's your desired market position? Well, it's competitive. You'd like to align with your competitors so that you're staying in the market, you keep your valued employees, and you're able to recruit and retain. Your pay practices, fair and equitable plus flexible. And that kind of goes into the pay plan type, which is open range. That means it's not steps, and so you're able to reward employees that perform, which goes into the next piece, which is the pay increase methods. So not only do you use cost of living analysis, or COLAs, you also are able to pay per performance so that you're actually keeping quality employees and you're encouraging them to perform at top standards. When we went out to market, we conducted a salary survey, and we looked at, while we were here, we said, who do you folks, as far as your employees, can feel are the county's biggest competitors for quality employees? We also used a tool, we looked at a circumference to see what other competitors would be in the area, and then we also talked to the project team. We came up with 23 competitors that we asked them to provide us with salary data. Please keep in mind, I'll repeat this as well, we're not getting actual salary as far as employees, we're getting salary ranges, okay? Because there's different reasons people are in different parts of their salary range. It could be they just started, it could be they're on a performance improvement plan, it could be they're out of family medical. So there's different reasons why employees are paid what they're paid. Unfortunately, just 16 of your competitors provided us with data. We feel that's defendable because you've got a good number of 16 is a good number of responses. And so we were able to look at this and consider that to be external competitiveness. The salary range data collected looked at benchmarks. What we did is we did a subset of all of your classifications throughout the county. So we ensured that all classifications were represented when we went out to market. Overall, the county, and please keep in mind, this is again ranges. It doesn't mean everybody's above, below, or in between. It's an average, okay? So at the minimum, which would be usually the starting range, the county is currently 8.3% behind its peers. At the midpoint, generally this is when a person's performing well and they're at market, the county is 9.6% behind its competitors. And then at the maximum, it's 10.4% behind the maximum. Please keep in mind again that this is not everybody below, it's an average as well. Okay. And then we created, based on all this data we collected from your employees, from your competitors, we created a new pay plan using best HR practices. And what you'll see is that there's 21 pay grades. You'll also see that there's different ranges. And this is best practice in that a starting range would, at the lower range of one and going all the way up to nine, you see a range of 50%. Okay, that's for the minimum starting to the maximum, okay? And then you'll see at range 10, it goes up, I'm sorry, maybe it's a little bit hard for me to see. It's actually 12, then it goes up to 55%. And then it goes on up and increases. It's sort of like a fan. And you may say, well, why is it different going up the scale? What we find is that employees that in the start of their career a lot of times will apply for new positions or change. They keep moving up, where if you're hired at one of the higher levels, generally you're where you will stay for many, many years. So there's no room for you to grow. So the pay range needs to be expanded so that you're actually not capping out. Okay. Sorry, I didn't realize that this. We had some last minute changes.
The monitor over your head might be better.
It might be, and you. We had also, I must confess, we had some last minute changes in. So this helps a lot because I was wondering what happened to that. So what we did was we decreased the number of pay ranges that you had. You had 32, we reduced them down to 27. And you might say, well, why did you do that? Because the others, once we did the actual new pay plan, were not appropriate. And the ones that were eliminated actually did not have positions within them. Okay. And as you will see, the range spreads. The 1 to 9 at 50%, 10 to 20 at 55%, and then 21 to 27 at 60%, like I explained earlier, that people stay in those positions longer at the higher levels. And the progression, meaning the maximum of one grade difference to the minimum of the following grade, is it starts out at 5% for grades 2 through 11, 6%, and it goes on up to 8%, as you'll see. Okay. But this is actually showing the competitors that we went out to market and collected data from. Okay.
Can you go back to that slide?
Yes, sir. We developed alternatives to transition your employees from the current pay plan into the new pay plan. And so all the options include cost of moving and new employees to the new position. Lowest grade minimum is the new pay grade minimum. So what we're really looking at is actually current range penetration, in that if they're in this range here, they'll move into the new range at the same penetration rate. And it's capped at point. We got the data from your team in December 6th, so the information we provide you is as up-to-date as possible. Okay, so there may be some changes, promotions, people being hired or terminated or something like that, but this is very real-time data. Please keep in mind the cost we're providing you is for salary only. It does not include benefits. Okay, and I just skipped ahead. Okay, so this is an option that we're presenting to you. It's current range penetration. It's capped at midpoint. What that means is perhaps you're at this spot in the current range. We're going to move you to the new range, and obviously the new range is higher because you're below market now. So you're actually going to transition to the new range in the same position, but it's going to be capped at midpoint, so no one's going to be placed above midpoint. Okay? And as you will see, the cost is $4,128,616. It impacts 1,183 employees, which is very positive. Okay, so our recommendations would be to implement the compensation classification structure. Obviously, going to communicate the good results, the good information to your employees, and we're happy to help you guys with the tool if you'd like to, us do that as well. And administer the new plan, communicate accordingly as the pay grades and adjustments are made. And with that, that's the presentation. I'm happy to answer questions, and I apologize that I'm going to have to run as soon as we through to catch the plane, not in the downtown Spartanburg Airport, but the other one.
Right. Do we want to give you a chance to cover anything before we open for questions or something?
Sure, I'm happy to do that. I'm prepared to give you a brief overview of kind of our key findings and takeaways from the results of the chair. We also have quite a bit of data associated with the referrals and drive form to share a few slides. Talk a little bit about the funding side of it and the implementation strategy, so we kind of have the full portfolio we're looking at here.
Cole?
Just before you start, what's the current
number of
total employees, right?
Total employees is about 1,550 to include part-time employees. We have about 1,350 full-time employees. So now that Cornell has ran through basically the methodology, the manner in which this was addressed, our pay philosophies, and how we're seeking to update some of those things, and also went through deliverables, comparables, so we'll talk a little bit about finding supply. So really unsurprisingly for us, what the data shows is that the greatest deviations from market tend to occur in the areas where, number one, we have historically the most trouble attracting, retaining, and recruiting. And those tend to be in the public safety arena and in the job classes that are technical oriented, so things like GIS and IT. So really for us, that was affirmation of what we thought to be true, what we thought we had seen in terms of turnover rates and the trouble we had just sort of anecdotally experienced in trying to attract and retain employees. And so that's where we've experienced the greatest changes. So the we have here just a list of the departments that are affected to the greatest extent. This is not an all-inclusive list, but just a sampling to give you an idea of where we have felt the greatest pressure and where we consequently, as part of the study, would make the greatest adjustments to bring these employees to market comparable rates. So those are environmental enforcement, about 14.73%. These are averages, which means individual employees would be affected to greater and lesser extents depending upon their particular position and where that particular position falls relative to our peers. But on average, about 14.73%. Probate court, about 10.94%. Turnover in this particular area can be problematic for Judge Caldwell, as she has a larger and larger volume of estates coming in, and it takes her, I believe, about 2 years to get someone trained up to be able to fully handle those. So the folks we have here are very important to us and very much have a direct impact on our productivity as an organization. The sheriff's office is off by about 9.49% on average. Communications, about 8.5%. This is an area like the sheriff's office, like detention, where we are constantly recruiting. We never stop recruiting because we know we'll always have turnover in those positions. And so this tells us that we are further off the mark than many other areas of the county, and that we need some adjustment here to help us be able to attract quality employees. Clerk of Court's office, about 8.43%. GIS and IT, just over 8 for GIS and about 7.4% for IT. These are the highly technical positions. In the GIS arena, we've tried on multiple occasions to attract quality employees for multiple positions without success. We've had to go external and have firms help us find employees because they've been that difficult, only to have folks leave us because they found higher paying jobs elsewhere within a few months. So these are particularly problematic areas for us. The coroner's office and detention is similar to the sheriff's office. We did make some adjustments to those particular pay structures a few years ago, but we only address entry-level salaries in some of the master deputy slash corporal level positions. And so in doing so, we created quite a bit of compression, and this study seeks to help prevent that compression. We also see adjustment about 6% almost on the landfill side and about 5.75% on the plant side. So from a funding standpoint, Quinnell told you the total dollar impact on an annualized basis for salary was about $4.128 billion, I believe. So the total cost to the county across all funds to include fringe benefits is about $5.3 million. The general funds portion of that is including fringe benefits to set aside as a pool of resources to help implement this fund. That was done on an annual basis. The And so that amounted to quite a bit of funding that we put aside in the existing budget. So given the fact that we are proposing a January implementation and we only have to carry 6 months of cost of a plan that will be $5.3 million over a full year, we're actually not that far off in terms of what we can fund for the current year absent any changes to the budget. So the budget for a full year of 4%, we're off the mark about 8.5% or so for 6 months, and so this number is going to be very similar from an appropriation standpoint. So given that, and as an example, the general fund, we had about $2,029,000 appropriated to implement. Our 6 month cost to include benefits is $1,856,000. So that is the near term problem of having fund implementation. Where we really spent most of our time and a considerable amount of discussion, debate, and analysis was looking at what the out year implication of funding such a recommendation would be. And so we wanted to be very careful and thoughtful to make sure that we weren't obligating the county, and in particular, its future year revenue growth, in order to make this decision today. And so we reviewed our existing revenue structure, we reviewed our tax estimates for the budget for this current year relative to what our projections are and relative to where we finished last year. And as I've shared with each one of you, we believe that our revenue structure is conservative enough from a budget standpoint, and that our revenue collections are strong enough that we can, within the existing revenue structure, fund that extra 6 months worth that effectively was not part of the FY20 budget. And so we estimate that we'll have about an extra $1.8, $1.9 million worth of tax revenue in the general fund that will allow us to pay for that other half. So effectively, that takes care of the general fund from a funding standpoint without accounting for or obligating new construction, assessment transfers, interest, renovations, additions, all those things that we count on for next year's budget to help fund positions or to pave roads or to deal with any of the pressures of growth from a service demand standpoint. So we've been very thoughtful to make sure we're not using up all that just to create a headache for us later when we come to you all seeking approval for a recommended budget in April or May, and we're trying to get new things done that will help alleviate some of the pressures of growth. So our revenues for general fund come by way primarily of current tax and the other funds. Our revenues aren't conservative enough in terms of the budget estimate and strong enough in terms of the actual collection trends that we feel like we can handle the additional amounts beyond what was set aside in the budget in those particular funds. So from an implementation standpoint, there will be a budget member resolution in your packet from the regular meeting that would authorize changes to the authorized staffing in the budget document. So this would update all of the job classes to the new pay scale. You will identify any title changes of the recommended Spartan study. You will identify the new grades. And there will also be a minor budget adjustment to a couple of funds, particularly the special revenue fund. We have things like school resource officers or grants where we may need to make some small adjustment. But for the general fund, there will be no budget adjustment that's necessary for this 6 month period in order to implement. So Evergreen has calculated all the individual changes on employees. We've obviously not shown that here on the screens today, but we have that for all the people who are impacted by that. And our next step, if council is able to proceed with the plan, will be to notify all employees of the changes, communicate that obviously to the department heads or elected employment officials who are applicable. And our goal really is to implement this with the first full pay period in January. Employees will begin to earn any increased amounts if it applies to them effective January the 4th. And then they would actually see that in their paycheck around January the 23rd or so. So they work for 2 weeks and then we have about 4 days for payroll. So they feel it really at the end of the pay around January the 23rd is when they actually see a level of increase if their pay is to be adjusted. And really at this juncture, we have a team who's waiting and ready to go to put all the changes into our system to kind of install the mechanics of how the payroll works and updating the salary amounts. We'd certainly be happy to answer any questions that you have, hear any concerns that you have regarding the proposal or the financial strategy for implementing it for the timeline.
Let me make sure I understand. This approved recommendation.
So approved the recommended.
Right. Now, on the list that you gave, the environmental of 14% no down, is that an average number for the department?
Correct.
It's not saying everybody is going to get that amount. Questions?
It's open to
any of you?
Not just the committee, so anybody got any questions?
I don't have a question, but I have a quick comment. I have more confidence in this, you know, classification and compensation study than I've ever had. I've seen a couple come before us in my time here, but I have more confidence in this, this study. And I think it does the right thing. Again, we're competing, as Cole said, I think did an excellent job with the article in the Herald Journal today. Our number one asset is our people. I mean, that's who Spartanburg County is, and that's who's enabled us to be able to be as successful as who we are. The team that we have, 1,400 plus employees, and they survived with us during the downtime. I mean, there were times when we didn't give an increase, and we didn't have enough money to actually do a study to figure out where we were. And we're very fortunate because this council's been very conservative, and also we've invested in the county, and now it's time to invest in our people. And I think this is a good thing to do, and even though I'm not on your committee at 5:30, I will vote to support.
Thank you for your comment. That reminds me, so there were, in the last 10 years, it's been about 11 years of pressures, financially and otherwise. So we had 4 years, FY 10, 11, 12, and 14, where there was no pay adjustment for employees, and I believe FY 18 was where we gave only a 0.5% increase for employees. And that effectively covered the increase they had in their retirement contribution rate. So we did that simply to make sure that they didn't receive less in take-home pay. During those years, oddly enough, if you add up the inflation, it's just over the figure that we're off the market. So effectively, inflation ate into quite a bit of what the earnings were during those periods, and that's where we find ourselves today.
Yeah, I look out across the room, and all those folks are mainly, you know, associates out there, you know, with us. I want to thank you all for staying with us too through all these years. I mean, it's for the love of what you do too. Obviously, it's not just the compensation, but every one of y'all contribute to the success in making us who we are.
Mr. Brown.
Thank you. I just want to say to all the employees, both current and past, I do want to apologize for this taking so long. I know this has been a conceptual idea in terms of doing this type of study and trying to bring up our salaries to the speed that we should have done. This council has been very conservative in my 11 years, but in some regard, it is, could be deemed as a day late, but hopefully it won't be a dollar short. I'm glad that this council, through our collective agreement, is willing to go forward on this. And I know we've had different iterations of people that have had the opportunity to sit up here, but this unified council is going forth with this, I hope. And I just want to say that with our past leadership and the consistent leadership with our new county administrator, we're just very thankful that we're moving forward. One of the questions I did want to have in regards to the way we've operated at times with piecemealing positions, with various departments coming to us out of budget, in the midst of a budget process, a year after, a year before, requesting certain positions that could be funded. What would be your take in terms of how we should approach that? Should we continue the piecemealing in some regards? And I don't mind saying it, I would deem it sometimes as taking care of those who can be selected by whoever comes and makes these requests. Nepotism, good old boy system, whatever. But what would be your approach in terms of how we handle those types of requests in the future in light of the fact that we are doing this across the board, if I can say that?
Sure. So I think it's fair to say that we've had a number of those requests over the years, to particularly in the recent years, to reclassify positions. I think that's a direct result of being off the market, and so people felt it imperative to come and request from council a reclassification to help them adjust pay to either attract, retain, and really at the end of the day to try to appropriately compensate folks for what they were doing. So I think given the fact that we've gone through this entire exercise, which is designed to be a recalibration to market and put us in a place where we're competitive, and assuming that we've accomplished that, and I believe that we have, I believe that we should be selective about those sorts of reclassifications that we take up, both in terms of what we recommend and what perhaps you all would consider proceeding with from our recommendations to make sure that in those instances where folks come, that truly it is necessary and it is, not to say that parlors were not necessary, but just to ensure that we are not taking up onesie twosies because someone didn't get an adjustment, we'd rather make sure that something has fundamentally changed about the duties that someone is doing such that we're no longer compensating them correctly. And so our just portion of their duties has changed and it no longer fits within the classification system that we've updated.
Okay.
Can I interject to reclassify to help with that?
In the midst of growth, obviously, from the county, there may be requests or need for expansion of certain areas in the county. How do we account for those positions as well?
So any additional positions would obviously come to county council through primarily through the budget process, and it would be incumbent on us to make the case for why we believe that service demands dictate that we have additional staffing areas. You'll feel some of this pressure, particularly in public safety, where call lines change with populations, perhaps, or in the infrastructure area where we know we have needs that we need to catch up on. But in terms of how we dealt with part of the study, we have went ahead and as part of the $5.3 million calculated the increase that would be necessary to take any vacancies to this current pay structure that's being proposed. So that's accounted for as part of this. And any frozen positions that were frozen as part of the budget process, none of that changes as a result of the recommendation. So we're not proposing to increase staffing or anything else. I hope that answers your question.
And if a frozen position does come online, it will come at the current recommended levels.
Any frozen positions, what happens with most of those is that they've been frozen for so long, the duties that once were probably on duties that need to happen now. So I think that's the tool that Quinnell is referring to, is that we're effectively
absolutely the requirements of what people are being paid. Contingencies. I know this year, next year, in the future, if there happened to be something had to come up.
Sure. So we've been very diligent as a county to make sure that we follow our financial policies, number one. And the number one rule is that you don't use one-time funding sources for recurring expenditures. And so we've been very diligent as part of our revenue budgets in particular to make sure that we are not counting on.
Not anymore. I got you.
No, we are not. So we're not using one-time funding sources like fund balance to fund positions, or we're not counting on large one-time industrial permits to carry the department going forward when some of those things will happen, and it's wonderful when they do. We don't know to what extent those things repeat themselves, especially if a recession happens. So we've been very careful to make sure we have appropriate financial safeties in place so that if there is a pullback of some nature, we have not set ourselves up to be structurally imbalanced. I think we've learned lessons in the past.
Let me ask you one other thing, Nicole, to make sure that everybody understands. Every single position.
I stepped out, she really was catching the flight. So even if we had two, let's say, administrative assistants, they both were given the opportunity and asked to fill out a job assessment tool because we don't know if they were appropriately called an administrative assistant.
Right.
If they were called that and they were doing something different entirely, we don't want to compensate them at the same rates. Just to find out that they really should have been called an accounting technician. Maybe that's not clear enough the designation, but you want to make sure you're calling people what they do and that you're compensating them appropriately. So we did look at all those. And we did find some that should be called something a little bit different.
And I would think you would say with some 1,400, 1,500 employees that you would ask them not to call y'all at one time.
Yes, in one.
Their situation. Yes. But I know Cole has spent what? 6 months now. It's been 6 months. It's been a lot of time and effort. He's very amenable to talk to anyone, I'm sure. I'm sure he's been looked at a number of times. And you look at, I think it's the point that I look at, we had 30 or 40 different classifications. We've reduced that, so that means that we're not trying to split so many out there is different ways, you know. So I think that's good to bring it down to a little more realistic. So.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
I agree with what my colleague said on this. I do follow everybody for taking the time to put forth effort to get this building. This is everybody will get paid what they fill out. They should get paid, or at least what they're
speak with their colleagues and other departments that are working in other counties. Just to make this clear, this is a clean slate, basically. This has nothing to do with merit. This is, we're starting over. Merit will be looked at in the future, but this is a clean slate moving forward.
That's correct. This is designed to be just a recalibration to effectively re-level the foundation. I do think we should strive to reward our employees and to compensate them based on performance. I think that's a healthy environment and a healthy thing that we should strive to attain. But in this case, this is not a consideration of merit. This is just re-leveling everything and making sure we have a good system that allows us to compete and a good foundation on this field.
Well, I would think you would find this council is very much aware, I think, in our discussions that this is the first step in making sure that we reward those employees that come early, come late, or do the extra, that down the road there's going to be other areas that we're going to look at, and that's just what we're talking about. But right now, we've got to start with the base, and that's what we're voting on tonight, is the base. So, any other questions? Roger?
I'm good. I concur with everything that's been said here today, and we're glad to be at this point.
All right.
I got here as quick as I could, Chairman Brown, Councilman Brown. That's, you know.
Do I have a motion that we approve the request, recommendation for the class and comment?
So
moved. Got a motion?
Second.
I have a second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
And I vote aye. And pass. The final item on our agenda is receive information and take desired action in reference to a resolution to update Spartanburg County Planning and Development Department fee schedule so as to establish the amount of certain fees in Spartanburg County. Mr. Cole Allison.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. So as a byproduct of the area performance planning process, we need to update our planning and development fee schedule. So we have provided to the committee and the council a draft fee schedule that attempts to bring fees over as closely as we could, hopefully, to the existing fee set schedule. So the new ordinances refer to zoning permits and other processes that just simply weren't covered in our schedule. And so we tried to find things that were comparable and to pair them up as close as we could. If there was no fee in the old ordinances, then we applied no fee in the new fee ordinances. There were a few where there was not a comparable item, and so we tried to find the closest one that we could in those cases to make sure that we weren't using this as an opportunity to increase fees or to change the revenue structure of the county, but simply just to have this be a mechanism to help us implement there before the time. And so we presented for you a fee resolution and update to the particular fee schedule of the planning department that attempts to do that. So we're happy to try to answer your questions that you have on that. This will be effective January 1st along with the performance area ordinance.
Is there anything that's a fee schedule and it's tied to the PCO? Is there anything that says that we need to do it tonight? I know you mentioned January 1st, and that's when you got to come. But there's a couple who have asked some questions about certain things in the questions. Would it hurt us to delay? I don't want you to put you on a hot spot here. Do what? 1 month to give us some time to look at some of those different increases or changes that we've got. Or I don't want to say increases. Some of them is questionable. Maybe we didn't even realize they were there, what we were charging in the past in some of that. So is there a problem there? I'm deferring to you.
Sure. So if we do not have a fee schedule in place, my understanding would be there is no fee for whatever that particular service is until we establish one. There would be some problems from an administrative standpoint, from a staff standpoint, really knowing what to charge when a process is highly similar to what was under the old ordinances. And if now we don't have a new fee set aside for that, we may effectively be decreasing or eliminating fee that would otherwise apply in the southwest area prior to January 1st. So we are having to try to answer some of those particular problematic areas. We've talked about that. Between now or between the meetings to see if we can get those to a place.
place where you're comfortable, or if there's debate on particular fees, I would suggest to adopt the schedule as proposed, and if you're uncomfortable with the fee, then to have those be zero for those particular items that you're uncomfortable with, and we come back in January and set the fee. You get 21 days or whatever it is.
Would it be easier, best for us, so that we bring the whole council in for our committee, this out, and so forth?
I think that'd be appropriate, that would allow discussion from council as a whole to make sure that you're comfortable.
Right.
If you want changes to the fee schedule, we can certainly deal with that part of the 5:30.
So Bob,
I'm going to propose that we move forward, we approve this resolution.
Fully aware that we're going to amend it like crazy.
And then, whenever it comes to the next committee, if we amend it or change, we'll go those steps.
Got that, Jack?
Do I have a motion that we proceed forward with this resolution?
So moved.
And a second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
And I vote aye, it passes. Mr. Chairman, that concludes our report.
All right, guys, if I could get y'all to step it up just a little bit, we are lagging. So, you're good, Jack. All right, and the next one is Michael Brown, Public Safety and Judiciary.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We have three principal items coming before committee, the first of which that we are typically graced with every year, but we're familiar with. To receive information, take desired action in reference to a request from Spartanburg League Track and Field Team to solicit funds for motorists on Saturday, February 1st, 2020. Saturday, March 14th, 2020, and Saturday, May 9th, 2020, between the hours of 9:30 a.m. and 5:30 p.m. to collect funds at the entrance to Peachwood Center Drive, which is between McDonald's and Academy, on the sides of Warren H. Abernathy Highway and between Ingalls and Mobile Gas Station on South Blackstock Road. As this council may be...
So moved.
Second. Move a second. Any questions? Not. I'll let all of you know what's on about.
All right.
Next, presentation regarding the update to the strategic plan for fire service in Spartanburg County. Chief Barry Frost, Chairman of the Fire Prevention and Protection Advisory Committee, presents for us.
Chairman Brown, members of the committee, I'm going to keep this short and sweet, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
Well, I come to you tonight, we appreciate the ordinance that y'all passed and we presented y'all a couple of months ago. But part of that ordinance change was something we had to look at was a strategic plan or a master plan that governs us, the Fire Advisory Committee. The problem is that ordinance stated we must follow that master plan, which was adopted May 13, 1992, almost 30 years ago. Kind of hard to do that. Population's been over 1,000. We've had a couple of $1 billion worth of investment in this county, but we're still working off of a plan that's almost 30 years old.
18.
See there, I knew David had to have that. Matter of fact, David was a young man in 1992 when we adopted it. That was the first meeting of the fire chief.
I went to. I was in my 30s.
Yeah. But my first meeting as fire chief was at Tracy Gaines Auditorium going over this master plan in 1992. But yet, we're still following. When we come before you, we looked at four things. We had a strategic plan meeting with the executive committee, with the Fire Chiefs Association. Some of those guys are here tonight. Spent 2 days looking at, we come up with four issues. Staffing is a big problem in this county with fire service. Volunteers are a dying breed. Training. We found out when we were looking at consolidation of some of the fire departments that some fire departments had zero certified firefighters on their roster, according to NFPA. We looked at communications. God bless Mike Flynn. I don't think you've had anybody extra working for you since you've been here. He's got 13 to 14 people working the shift. In most counties our side, that number's 25 to 30 working in communications. The biggest problem I have with communications is we can't communicate with EMS nor law enforcement on the fire side. Tell me another county our size that can say that. If we have an active shooter, we have to go through communications, relay that to the police department, or relay that to the EMS. We can't communicate with them. That's a problem. Technology's out there to help us with this, to help Mike with communication, to help the fire service. We need to invest in that technology. But the best part of all, I'm not asking for no money from y'all. We have the money to do it. We just ask for your blessing. Let us do it, come up with an RFP, put it out there, bring that study back to this council and say, we're gonna follow this new master plan. Not do so, the entry crosshair and Hopkins bill suggested to merge 27 years ago and just happened 2 years ago. That's the problem. That's the problem. We ask them to bring this to y'all, y'all adopt it, give it back to us to enforce it. That's what we're asking.
You preach it to the choir.
I ain't me a brother, talk about it.
You are preaching.
I get paid not to preach. You pass that around, Bob. I take the offer later. But you have any questions, more glad to answer those questions, guy. But I'm passionate about the fire service in this county. So is that group back there sitting in the back. We want to make this county one of the best counties in the state of Stockton when it comes to fire protection. We've got a lot of work to do and a long way to go. But we can get there. And I want to say thanks to Cole and his staff, the guys back there, Mike, Chris Mass, and everybody that went with us, Bill Hall, the fire marshal. We looked at a lot of issues. And I think we move forward, get an outside agency coming in, we can get to where we need to be.
We appreciate y'all.
Mr. Chairman, can I ask a question, please?
Barry, why haven't we done it?
Well, I've got an RFP here. I can tell you, I've got an RFP here that was written in 2009. It wasn't going to happen in 2009. That's 2009. It was shot down because I think Cole just mentioned it. 2010, do I get pay raises?
No.
2000, it'd be kind of hard for us to spend some money if you ain't getting pay raises.
But if we're not having to
pay
you, you said you're not asking us for any money. The money's there.
We've got the money in our budget with fire protection.
Why aren't we doing it now?
That's the reason I'm here, sir. Let us do the RFP. Let us get this out there, get something back in for the end of the year, and look at the proof.
Just for the record, what are we going to spend?
Sir?
What is it going to cost just for the record?
I would say probably $100,000 plus to look at it. But we want to look at everything we can to see what we can do to make this better. Remember now, in 1992, we was talking tanker shuttles. We didn't have that much for our infrastructure. We looked at ISO ratings, how we could build fire stations. Well, that's great. We built fire stations and put nobody in them. Now we've got to build with trucks and nobody that. So we want to look. We want our people come to y'all wanting money to build fire stations. Want to buy equipment? Be sure it meets our master plan. If you're not going to put people in the station, you don't need to build a station. That's $1 million plus.
I'm not talking about stations. I'm talking about when you said that if there's an active shooter situation going on where the fire department can't talk to the sheriff's department and got to go through Mike's department, that's ridiculous. I mean, yes. We're not talking about building things. Let's do something.
And the crazy thing about that, on the economic side, when you build that building, they have to go in there and put radio communications for us on the fire side and everybody else with the county on 800 megahertz, we can go in there and do one system, 800 megahertz, and save those people's buildings, investing millions of dollars, and not have to put a $100,000 repeater system.
I'm not talking about buildings again, I'm talking about persons.
That's what I'm talking about. But you have to put those repeaters in those buildings now, according to building codes.
Whoever's slowing you down, let us know. Let's get it done.
Be more than that, sir. My turn.
Well, Chief, will the council and help the administration? Hey, we look forward to working with you.
Do I need to be here at 5:30, sir?
No need.
Why would you miss that?
Thank y'all.
Appreciate it.
Get ready for Sunday.
Yes, sir.
Receive the next item. We're to receive information and take desired action in reference to an uncodified ordinance to authorize the sale of county-owned property. Identify as tax map number 4-06-00-1, containing approximately 0.50 acres. Take a look, Cole.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. So last month, we talked to you about entering into a lease agreement with Greenville Fire to locate an EMS station there. Tommy told you that he'll be coming back and asking for council to convey a piece of property that we owned and originally purchased to build an EMS facility. And that you convey that to the Greenville Fire Department. Per the terms of our negotiation with them, the lease will be subject to this. So if council chooses not to convey the property, the lease would go away. So this is simply the next step in that process. So it's an ordinance to convey over to Greenville Fire for the EMS section.
Any questions, sir?
This would have to be, since the conveyance of property, this would have to be a unanimous decision, council.
Move.
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 further questions, all in favor, let it be known by the sign of aye. So this is all the full council. The expeditious mandate has been given. Mr. Chairman, the expeditious mandate has been met.
You did well. You did well. Next, let's see how Roger does. The next one is land use. Roger Nutcher.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Tonight we're going to go over the Spartanburg County floodplain ordinance. Do I have a motion?
I move that we approve the ordinance as amended for this meeting.
Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? It passes. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. That's all we got.
That's the way you do that.
What did we do? We didn't do anything.
We just messed with your house.
I'm next. You ready?
Yes.
Mr. Chairman, tonight we're going to give a real quick update, and the slowest part of this is going to be Earl's pushing the button pictures up.
Well, let's look at my pretty pictures now.
I know. They're going to be nice.
These monitors.
This is a capital penny update for the judicial building and necessary appurtenances. All the buildings along Library Street where the parking deck will go have been, somebody ran into them with a big old crane and a backhoe.
That's a Cabelco excavator.
Of course it is.
Good, yeah. Drive it down the road.
Straight from District 6. Thank you very much. Demolition began the first week of December. As you can see, a lot of great structures going on there. The design team is making progress on the final plans, and we're just trying to make sure we get the parking deck where we want it. That's going to be the first building that's going to be built, of course, just to make room for the cars, which we're going to start doing construction within the current parking lot. So we got a parking garage built. We're going to go before the city's design review board on January 2nd for the second of three approvals. We're going to have some renderings to be shown in January. When we come back for the January meeting, we'll have some really good renderings about that building and probably the courthouse as well. Collection so far, which is a big deal, collections so far are $7 million ahead of expected, which is fantastic. And the project is still on budget as it was from the very beginning. So things are looking really good for the project. We'll have a whole lot more of an update in January when we got some permits and some other things going on, but this is the first sign of some major things going on down there at the courthouse site, and we'll bring more to the council on the next January meeting.
Thank you.
That's all we got.
Thank you so much. Looking forward to the January meeting, and it's good to see those pictures.